Well, good morning, everyone. So good to be with you this morning. My name is Cory. I am the campus pastor here at the North Shore. And it's been a couple of weeks since I've been up here preaching, but I typically get the great opportunity to be gathered here with you and share God's word. And this morning, it's always fun to start a new series. This is a really great series. We're excited about it. Right out of Genesis chapter 37 to 50, a great story about the life of Joseph. But I want to encourage you to turn in your Bibles this morning. You're going to need those. If you don't have a Bible, there's a Bible in front of you in one of the chairs. Just kind of look below on the rack below you. And Genesis, if you're not sure where that is, it's the very first book of the Bible. And so just go to the first book of the Bible and find 37 chapters in. That sounds like a lot, but it's really not that far into the book of Genesis. So that's where we're going to be this morning. I wonder this morning, by the way, if you've ever wondered, and it's kind of a crazy question, I think, about asking this, because I feel like everybody's wondered this, but have you ever wondered if God actually has a plan for your life? Have there been times in your life, moments in your life, maybe prolonged seasons in your life, maybe even right now this morning, you're here and you're wondering, God, do you actually have a plan for me, for my life? Well, I want to read over you God's word and what God's word has to say about this. Psalm 139, King David wrote these words. He said to God, he's writing this directly to him, "You, God, formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them." That is an incredible passage. I just want you to know, right at the very beginning of this message, in the beginning of this series, that God most certainly has a plan for your life, and that plan started all the way back in time. That God had a plan from the moment that you were conceived. In fact, even from before that moment, God had a plan for you. He's the one who was at work in you the moment you were conceived in your mother's womb. There you were. He was the one who also stated so clearly that if God has a book, right? The text says here, in your book, talking to God, in your book, God, are written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, before there was even one of those days. So yes, God has a plan for you. But we don't always feel that God has a plan for us, do we? And so sometimes what happens is what we feel like and what we're going through comes into collision against what God's word says. And what we want to do is, in times like that, we want to always go back to God's word to remind us what God says. With this text, by the way, we should also clearly infer from this text, and it's more than just an inference, that you are of great worth and value to God. That you actually really matter to God. And you may be here this morning, you might be thinking, you know, I'm not so sure I even know if I matter to God. You do matter to God. This text tells us that you do. That you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Notice the detail in this passage about how God was actively at work in your growth and development from the time of conception. You are of great worth and value to Him. God has a plan. In fact, there's this great passage in the book of Acts in chapter 13, verse 36, that just simply says this about King David. "For David, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, fell asleep and was laid with his fathers." You know, I think that can be said of all of us. When the time comes that we hopefully get to the end and we can say, you know, I served the purpose of God. I lived my life how God wanted. God had a purpose and a plan for me, and I lived in accordance with his purpose and his plan for my life, and I can fall asleep and be laid with my fathers. In other words, I can die now. And while it's true that God has a plan for every life, and we can see that in Scripture clearly, this does not mean, of course, that we can see His plan at all times with great clarity. In fact, certain realities of life that we all go through make it actually very difficult at times to even see the plan. Life has so many ups and downs, doesn't it? So many highs and lows, joys and sorrows, victories and defeats, triumphs and trials or tragedies. All of these things are part of the human existence. We all have those. During these times, in fact, it can be very difficult. The times when we're down or we're low or we're in sorrow or we're defeated or we're in trials or in tragedies. During those times, it can be exceptionally difficult to see God's plan. In dark times in our lives, we're only able to see the road, in fact, directly that's in front of us. Almost as if we're driving through the thickest fog in life. It's night. The lights are on, and all you can see is a few feet in front of you on the road. And the best that you can do in times like that is to simply slow your vehicle way down and focus on the yellow line in the center of the road and on that winding road as you continue to go. You know that that road is taking you somewhere, but you don't know exactly the details of the road ahead. But you keep going forward, and inch by inch you do that until you get to your destination. You see, life is just like that sometimes, isn't it? I've had that fog. I trust that you probably have had that too, maybe at various points in your life, and maybe even here this morning. You know, I wonder in times like that, that if you could see the big picture of your life, including every single detail, if you could have it all played out in front of you in advance, every up and every down, every high and every low, every joy, every sorrow, every victory, every defeat, every trial, every triumph. If you could see it all, would you choose to see it? Would you want to see that? Would knowing God's plan and purpose in every single one of those seasons of your life, would that help you? Would that help you to be encouraged and to remain steadfast in your devotion and your commitment to Christ to follow Him? Perhaps. But then I wonder, why would you need to trust God? Because you know everything. You see the entire road in front of you. All the guesswork is gone. All the wondering is removed. And you know everything. And there's things that you know that you wish you didn't know now. At that point, what would be the point of even faith if you could see everything you see? Because faith infers that you actually don't get to see with clarity. It's about trusting. I don't know if you enjoy reading biography, but there's a beauty to be found in biography. I love reading biography, but I rarely ever get to read biography, it seems, these days. And that's really just an excuse because I read a bunch of other stuff, and I could read biography. And I look at them on my shelf, and I think, man, I want to pick that up again, or I want to read that biography. But there's so many amazing biographies that are out there. And I find, especially for me as a Christian, I love reading biographies of those who've been faithfully following Jesus. And a lot of the biographies that I have read over the years are the biographies of people that have come and gone. They're not alive currently. Men and women like George Whitefield, Jonathan Edwards, J.C. Ryle, Hudson Taylor, George Mueller, John G. Patton, David Brainerd, Cory ten Boom, Elizabeth Elliot, Jim Elliot, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the list could go on, and Joni Erickson Tada. How could forget Joni? Some of those names maybe are familiar to you, maybe you don't know any of those names. Maybe you have different people that come to your mind when you think about amazing biographies. But I will tell you from a Christian perspective, reading biographies is so good for your soul. Because you and I get an opportunity to see in somebody's life the after part. At the end of the life, when it's over, when it's all said and done. Reading biographies of those whose lives have come and gone is remarkable because we get to look back over their lives and we find encouragement and we find hope from the way that they lived for Jesus. Every one of the individuals I mentioned sought to live for God and follow His plan for their lives. And every one of them faced significant ups and downs, highs and lows, joys and sorrows, victories and defeats, triumphs and tragedies. Every one of them. I think, for example, of John G. Patton, missionary to the New Hebrides people that were cannibalists. He got there and his wife dies and his newborn dies and he buries them. and he has to lay over the graves so that the cannibals don't dig up his family members. Or I think of Cory ten Boom and the significant suffering that she went through. Or Joni Erickson Tada, for example, who even to this day you think and hear about her story and the amazing ways in which God has woven into her life this really times of suffering and difficulty and pain and hardship, and how she follows Jesus so faithfully. Or Jim Elliot and the group that was with him as missionaries, Jim and his wife Elizabeth, and how Jim, among the other missionaries, was speared to death when they made first contact with people that had never heard the gospel before. You see, in all of their lives, and in our lives as well, they're like a book. If you think about your life, think about it like a book for a moment. It's a book filled with chapters. The chapters are actually still being written from our perspective, right? We are, or maybe you're at chapter 40 in your life right now, or maybe you're at chapter 15, or maybe you're getting close. You think maybe, I don't know how many more chapters I've got, God. But the chapters are being written. From your vantage point, life is unfolding. You have it coming in front of you. And page by page, it's being written. Chapter by chapter, it's being written. And the story I would tell you, the story of your life, the story of my life, the story of everyone's life is often greater than the chapters. The story is often greater than the chapters. In other words, some chapters in our lives are downright difficult, painful, and confusing. You look at the chapter and you're like, God, where were you in this? Like, what happened in this? What's going on in this chapter? And especially those chapters if you're living them right now. Yet looking back over all the biographies, when you read them, you look back over all, it is often, isn't it, only in hindsight that we can actually see the details of God's overall plan or story for our lives. And this is so true for the biography of Joseph in Genesis 37 through 50. In those 13 chapters, we're given a glimpse into some of the details of Joseph's life. We're not told every single thing about his life. We're told specific things about his life. But those 13 chapters chronicle how God was at work in his life to bring about his purpose and his plan for Joseph, a plan that would actually have far-reaching impact on not only his own family, but also many others for generations to come. And yet the chapters in this story are filled with heartache and suffering at the hands of others. If you read just one of the chapters, you might walk away and say, wow, what a horrible life. But that's the way chapters are. But you got to read the whole book. So this morning, we're going to embark on the journey. We're going to begin together a journey through the life of Joseph. So I want to invite you again to turn in your Bibles to Genesis 37 if you're not there already. And in our text, I want you to see three things this morning from this text. It's really kind of a walkthrough of this text. It's 36 verses. We're going to walk through it. We're going to draw out a couple of applications out of this at the end. But the first thing I want you to know in Genesis 37, the account of Joseph in this passage begins with Joseph in the house of his father. That's where it's situated in the context. He's in the house of his father, not literally in the house, but in terms of this is where he lives. He's 17 years of age. We pick up the text in verse 1. Jacob lived in the land of his father's sojournings, in the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was pasturing the flock with his brothers. He was a boy with the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought a bad report of them to their father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of the other sons because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a robe of many colors. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peacefully to him. Now Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. He said to them, "Hear this dream that I have dreamed. Behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and behold, my sheaf arose and stood upright, and behold, your sheaves gathered around it and bowed down to my sheaf." His brothers said to him, "Are you indeed to reign over us? Or are you indeed to rule over us?" So they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. Then he dreamed another dream and told it to his brothers and said, "Behold, I have dreamed another dream. Behold, the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars are bowing down to me." But when he told it to his father and to his brothers, his father rebuked him and said to him, "What is this dream that you have dreamed? Shall I and your mother and your brothers indeed come and bow ourselves to the ground before you?" And his brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the saying in mind. You know, to understand the story of Joseph as it rolls forward from 37 all the way to 50, you actually have to go backwards a little bit before 37, because we have to set kind of the context to understand what Joseph's, the house that he lived in, what it was actually like. You know, he's in the house of Jacob. This is his father. But what is Jacob actually like? Well, let's go back even further than that for a moment, briefly, to describe where Jacob actually came from. You see, Jacob, his parents were Isaac and Rebekah. All the way back earlier in the book of Genesis. And Isaac and Rebekah, they had two children. They had twins. They had Jacob and Esau. And Esau gets deceived, actually, by Jacob as they grow up together. And actually, what you read about in the early account is that Isaac loved his son Esau, but Rebekah, the mother, loved Jacob. Right away at the story, early on, you get this picture that there's an sort of inequity in terms of parental love for the children. And so what you find as you read through the account in Genesis is that Jacob eventually comes to the point he's actually known as a deceiver, and he actually deceives his brother by stealing what's called the birthright away from his brother Esau over a bowl of stew, of all things. You read about Jacob, and what he does is he eventually marries four women. He loves one of them, in fact, more than all of the others. His wives are Leah and her sister Rachel. He really wanted to marry Rachel, but he himself was also deceived and tricked by Leah and Rachel's father, and he ended up actually having first as his wife Leah. How that all happened, I don't exactly understand. How he didn't know, but he didn't. He eventually gets Leah as well, but he also along the way gets two other wives, the servants of these women, Bilhah and Zilpah. He has a total of four actual wives. And from these four wives, a whole bunch of kids come, and they grow up actually knowing that their mother, whether it's Bilhah, Zilpah, or Leah, because at this point it's just those three women that have all the children, and the women are all fighting for the love and the affection of Jacob at this point. They're like, "I've got to have more kids, and then I'll basically win his love, and he'll love me." And another one's like, "Well, I'm going to have more kids, because he's going to love me. Oh, she just had a kid. I better make sure I get to sleep with him so that I can have another kid." And they're all sort of battling for Jacob's love and affection. But Jacob's real love is for Rachel, who can't have a kid yet. Finally, she has a kid, and who is that kid? His name is Joseph. This kid is the youngest at this point. Dad's favorite. You know, that favoritism piece carries over, doesn't it, from Jacob's early days all the way now to him as a dad. With a woman he really loves. And he shows this favoritism to Joseph in a number of ways. And in our text this morning, all the other sons actually see it. In particular, what Jacob does that causes them to see it sort of in this text, they saw it all through the years. This was nothing new to them. But when we get to our text in Genesis 37, they see it in a visible, tangible way when Jacob gives his son this coat of many colors. And some people kind of discuss, what is this coat exactly? Some people say, well, it signifies a little bit, but that Joseph is never going to be like the rest of the guys. He's never going to be out there working in the field, taking care of the flock. He's kind of going to be in the manager of them, kind of the boss of them, so to speak. Here he is as a 17-year-old. Life in Jacob's home is not the greatest. I hope you get that picture. In fact, what's really interesting is he's got four wives, but at the very beginning, God said, like, one man, one woman, not four. It's not a great picture. In fact, it's a very dysfunctional home. And also, it actually seems like he's actually a little bit of a lousy dad, to be honest with you. He seems to be a little bit indifferent. In fact, there was a time, even in fact, where he had all of these kids, and one of them actually was a girl. Her name was Dinah. And in Genesis chapter 34, Dinah gets actually raped by an individual, Shechem. And instead of Jacob doing something about it, he really does nothing. And it's his two sons who actually later on in the story, you find out that they decide to take matters into their own hands, and they go and they kill the people that did this to their sister. Where is Jacob in all this? Like, what kind of a man is this? Added to all of this, there is Joseph now, who, as his son, what does he do in our text? In chapter 37, he brings this bad report to his dad about his brothers. He looks like he's a snitch. That's what he looks like. Now, I'm not 100% personally convinced that he's a snitch here. It may just, in fact, be that he's actually 17-year-old. He can't necessarily help it that he's got the favor of his dad, that his dad's doing all this for him, that his dad shows him love and affection more than he shows the others. And he may be getting mistreated by the other brothers, and he may be going home and just going, "Dad, like, my brothers are just being brutal to me." Now, typically when people read this, I think they read that he's a bit of a snitch. He's a little bit of a snotty kid. He's 17 years of age, and here he is. He's got his coat of many colors, and they view Joseph from a negative light at that point. And that may very well be the case. But he's also a dreamer, we're told in the text. And he comes with this one dream that he brings to his brothers. But they know that he's a dreamer. This isn't his first dream that he's ever had, according to the text. He is a dreamer. In verse 8, and in fact, they hated him for his dreams and for his words. And he tells them this dream, and the brothers interpret that dream and say, basically, in this dream, you're saying you're going to reign over us. Like, who in the world do you think you are? You can see how the entire story in Genesis builds to this point, this sort of like high point in the story in chapter 37, where it's not just the coat that does all this. It's all the stuff in Jacob's home that builds up to this with the coat, and then this dream on top of it, where the brothers are like, we're sick of this guy. Like, we've had it with him. He's daddy's little boy. He's daddy's favorite kid. Dad loves him more than anybody else. He shows him favor all the time. And the brothers now get all of this sort of significant anger and bitterness that wells up in this. All of this family dysfunction sits here in the back of our text. This is not a great chapter in that regard. You might read this chapter and say, well, I can resonate with this chapter, at least in this. I know what it's like to have a dysfunctional family or come from a dysfunctional family. I get that. Not quite like this, but in a different way, for sure. For sure, that was my upbringing. But that's the first thing I want you to see, that the home life is a pretty terrible home life, it seems here. But I want you to notice also the second thing from the account of Joseph is that the text tells us about the hatred of his brothers. So he's in the house of his father, but we have to sort of bring out for you in this text how his brothers actually behave and how they treat Joseph. I want you to notice again in verse 4, if you're looking at the text, in verse 4 it specifically says, when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him. And then look at verse 5. Now Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. And then look at verse 8. His brother said to him, are you indeed going to reign over us? Or are you indeed to rule over us? So they hated him even more. Like, how much more can you hate the guy? Like, I hate him. We hate him even more. And now we hate him even more. On top of all of that, in verse 11, his brothers, we're told, are jealous of him. So you can see for these brothers, a part of me when I read this story, I think, man, these brothers are horrible human beings. And that's true. In many respects, they're horrible human beings. There's another part of me that goes, I can see why they're horrible human beings. You know, hurting people hurt people, right? Hurting people hurt people. These are hurting people. These are people that have been through much kind of in this family. This just didn't pop out of nowhere. This isn't just sort of one thing. It's like, I got upset about a coat and now I'm going to really hate my brother. It's a whole bunch of things that lead up to this. And that's usually the way it is, right? It's not one thing. It's a multitude of things. And so we here have this great hatred that his brothers have for him. And now in Genesis chapter 37, verse 12 to 17, Joseph actually leaves the house of his father. His father, Jacob, sends him on a little bit of a mission, if you will. And this is what he says. Now his brothers went to pasture their father's flock near Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock at Shechem?" By the way, when you're reading this, I think you're supposed to probably, when you're reading all of Genesis, keep this in mind, and I'll draw your attention to it. They're in Shechem again. Shechem is the place where Dinah was raped. And it's the same place where Simeon and Levi, when they found out about their sister being raped, that they went in there and they actually slaughtered the men of Shechem. And now you have the brothers are there in Shechem, and they're actually pasturing the father's flock near Shechem. And Israel, that is Jacob, he said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock at Shechem? Come, I will send you to them." In other words, I think we're supposed to infer from this that Jacob is maybe a little bit concerned about his brothers, maybe. Like, they're in Shechem, go check on them. And he said to them, "Here I am." So he said to him, "Go now, see if it is well with your brothers and the flock, and bring me word." So he sent him from the valley of Hebron, and he came to Shechem. And then in verse 15, a man found him wandering in the field, and the man asked him, "What are you seeking?" Now, if you're reading this sort of in the broader context of Genesis, you might be thinking, man, I'd be a little bit worried if I was out there in the fields, knowing that two of my brothers, Simeon and Levi in Genesis 34 rose up and they came back and they slaughtered a whole bunch of the men of Shechem. And now I got this man who finds me, Joseph, walking out in the fields. I'd be worried that he's coming to do me harm, but he's not in this text. A man finds him wandering the fields. We don't know anything about this man. The man asks him, "What are you seeking?" Like nothing in terms of detail or color about this individual at all. Just randomly there out of nowhere. Joseph said, "I'm seeking my brothers," he said. "Tell me, please, where are they pasturing the flock?" Like this random guy out in the middle of nowhere happens to now know where the brothers are located. Notice this in verse 17. The man said, "They've gone away, for I've heard them say, 'Let us go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. Now, you're at this point in the story, if you're reading through this, or we've tracked through all the way to verse 17, you might be going, okay, like, where's God in this story? Like, where is he? This is an absolute mess. The family is a mess. The brothers are brutal. I mean, the horrible things that happened to Dinah. Like, it's just an absolute mess. It's like reading today's newspaper almost. Where is God? You know, the only thing in the text at this point that would give you an indication that God is somewhere here in the text is what? The dream that Joseph has. But even then, let's just stop and pause on that for a moment, this dream that he has. There's no really information about the dream other than there's a dream. Like, it doesn't tell you anything about how this dream is going to happen, when it's going to happen, nothing. It just is a dream. And the brothers infer from the dream that Joseph thinks he's going to reign and rule over us. So where's God in this text? Where's God in this chapter? Reading on in chapter 37, verse 18, the brothers saw Joseph from afar, and before he came near them, they conspired against him to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes this dreamer." It's sort of this whole kind of language just laced with sort of disdain, isn't it, for the brother? Here comes this dreamer. You can just sort of almost feel just the loathing coming out in the language here, the hatred. They said to one another, "Here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we will say that a fierce animal has devoured him, and we will see what will become of his dreams." That's the plan. Kill our brother. Bitterness, jealousy turns to anger. Anger left stirring and stewing inside of them turns to the point that they're ready to actually shed blood. Verse 21, but when Reuben heard it, Reuben is the oldest in the family. When Reuben heard it, he rescued him out of their hands, saying, "Let us not take his life." And Reuben said to them, "Shed no blood. Throw him into this pit here in the wilderness, but don't lay a hand on him." So the pit's a good idea, but just throw him in alive. Don't kill him and throw him in the pit. And then there's sort of this sort of look, parenthetical kind of note, that he might rescue him out of the hand, their hand, to restore him to his father. So his plan is probably, as the oldest, going, okay, let's get rid of the brother, let's throw him in the pit, I'll be a part of this whole plan, don't kill him, just throw him in the pit. And then his thinking, he's like, I can come back some other point and I can rescue my brother, get him out, and get him back safely to dad. Now, why would he do that? He hates him. Well, there's a backstory here, right? The story of dysfunction, and it gets even worse, actually, here with Reuben. You see, because in Genesis 35, verse 22, you know what Reuben did? He slept with one of his dad's wives before this. He's in the bad books with dad big time. He actually took Bilhah, one of the wives, and he actually had relations with her. So I think part of the backstory here for Reuben is like, listen, I don't want this to be on my watch as the firstborn, as the one who's the oldest in the family. I want to probably just say, like, let's just throw him into the pit. And in his plan, he's like, I don't want to have further problems with dad over this. Verse 23, so when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe. Notice sort of the irony of that, right? They see the robe in a certain light, and they strip him of this, right? The robe of many colors is off him. They take him, in verse 24, and throw him into a pit. The pit was empty. This was simply a pit for water. This is a water source where water would go, and it was a cistern, and it was probably dirty and ugly, and they would just throw him into that pit and leave him there. And notice what they do, how callous and cold that they are. In verse 25, they sat down to eat. Who does something like that and just sort of, guys, let's get out our lunch. Hey, let's get Uber Eats to deliver something over here, right? Like, who sits down after doing such a horrible thing to eat? But they do. And looking up, they see a caravan. Because caravans just happen to be there, and it's a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead with their camels bearing gum, balm, and myrrh. You know what those are spices for burial? Isn't that interesting? This is sort of a burial spices being hauled by these Ishmaelites, and they're on their way to Egypt. They're taking these spices to Egypt. This is almost like the author of Genesis is saying to us, you know, the smell of death is here in this story, isn't it? Burial spices. Verse 26, then Judah said to his brothers, what profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites. So the plan is evolving. Its plan is changing, right? Let's sell him, actually, instead. Let's not just leave him in the pit. Let's sell him to these guys that are traveling through. And let not our hand be upon him, for he is our brother, our own flesh. And his brothers listened to him. The Midianite traders passed by, and they drew Joseph up, lifted him out of the pit, and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 shekels of silver. They took Joseph to Egypt. And that's the story. Joseph goes from his father's house to Egypt. And then there's the big cover-up. In verses 29 to 36, there's the cover-up of it all with dad. When Reuben returned to the pit, remember, he was going to go to the pit and rescue his brother. And he saw that Joseph was not in the pit. He tore his clothes and returned to his brothers and said, the boy is gone, and where shall I go? Why is he asking that question? Because he knows he's already messed up royally with Jacob by sleeping with Bilhah. And now he's got blood on his hands because the brother is gone. Verse 31, then they took Joseph's robe and slaughtered a goat and dipped the robe in the blood, and they sent the robe of many colors and brought it to their father and said, and notice the deception here. Notice the deception that's being wielded against Jacob, who actually is known earlier in Genesis as the deceiver. The deceiver is actually deceived now by his own children. This we have found. Please identify whether it's your son's robe or not. And he identified it and said, it is my son's robe. A fierce animal has devoured him. Joseph is without doubt torn to pieces. And he's so right. A fierce animal did destroy him. His brothers. We're supposed to see in this that this is what's happening here. The fierce brothers actually have destroyed Joseph, it appears. Verse 34, then Jacob tore his garments, put on sackcloth on his loins, and mourned for his son for many days. All his sons and daughters rose up to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted and said, "No, I shall go down to Sheol, that is to the grave, to my son, mourning." Thus his father wept for him. Meanwhile, the Midianites had sold him in Egypt to Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, the captain of the guard. So the story as we see it unfolding, the life of Joseph, this chapter, chapter 37 in his life, tells us of how he went from the house of his father Jacob into the house of Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh in Egypt, the captain of the guard. And God, where are you in all this stuff? I mean, such a loving and nurturing family. Makes you glad that you didn't grow up in Jacob's house. That's our account. And if you were to step away from this account at this point, you'd probably walk away and go, wow, what do we pull out of this account? Well, we pull out of this account that in Genesis chapter 3, Adam and Eve sinned against God. They were created by God and placed in the garden, and they sinned against God. And from Genesis chapter 3 all the way through Genesis, all the way up to 37 and beyond, and even to our day, we are dealing with the ravages of sin. The devastating effects that sin has upon our home and our own lives and our family, our own hearts and souls. It's true. It's ravaging people, right? We all experience it. We all deal with sin. But that would be the principal point of application that would come out of this at this point. If you're looking at just 37, you might walk away and say, wow, what a horrible story about the ravages of sin. Is there somebody that can rescue us from the ravages of sin? The answer is yes. His name is Jesus. That's what you would do at this point. But I don't think that's the main point of this text. It certainly is an application point. But I don't think that's the main point of this. I've entitled this message, God's Invisible Hand, for a reason. Sort of on an earthly plane, you can't see his hand here in the story. It's really hard to see it anywhere. Where is God in anything in this text? Well, this account of Joseph, thirdly, I want to point out to you, in Genesis 37, is about the hand of his God. That's what it's about. I debated whether making this a third point or whether just simply saying, this is the application point right here, this is it. And you might say to yourself, well, where is the hand of God in this? Like, how is God's hand in this at all? I don't see it in the text, and you're right. You wouldn't see it directly in the text unless you read the whole story. You see, it's the whole story, Genesis 37 to 50, that gives us perspective. The whole story. If you look at the chapters in life are not always the greatest, but the whole story is the greatest. The whole story helps you to understand the chapters. The chapters don't help you understand. It's not the other way around. From Genesis 37, 1 through 36, you might have difficulty seeing God's plan, yet he's actively involved. I can tell you this. How do I know? Because in Genesis 45, years later, Joseph, who's been away from his brothers for years, has not seen them. He says these words to his brothers. When he finally sees them, "And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors." See the purpose that he sees in all of the pain? In verse 8, "So it was not you who sent me here, but God. You brothers didn't send me here. God sent me here. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt." Now, we're not there in the story of Joseph yet. We're going to make our way there. But it helps to know the whole story, because the whole story, we get perspective, don't we? Can we see the hand of God in Genesis 37? Yes, absolutely you can when you know the whole story. One author said, in the events of Genesis 37, God seems completely absent from the minds of Jacob and his sons, and that is true. But that by no means indicates that God was not actively involved in what was happening. Okay, where? John Piper, in his book on Providence, says this: the sequence of events by which God would save this family from the coming famine was set in motion through a tangle of sins, including fatherly favoritism and brotherly jealousy and hatred. Piper goes on to say, with this constellation of sins against Joseph and his father, the brothers had set in motion an astonishing sequence of events that would lead to their own deliverance from famine. Wow. I want you to consider, as you kind of retrace Genesis 37 briefly with me, retrace it with Genesis 45, verses 5 through 8 in mind. And I ask you, can you see God's invisible hand at work, even in the midst of severe family sins and dysfunction? Can you see his hand? Joseph grew up in a dysfunctional home where his father Jacob favored him and gifted him with a coat of many colors, all of this adding to the long-standing bitterness and anger of Joseph's brothers. That was kind of a needed part of the story, wasn't it? That anger and hatred of the brothers is actually what brought about the brothers' actions, getting him onto that caravan on the way to Egypt, right where God needed him to go. Yeah, Joseph has a dream from God, for sure. We see that in verses 5 through 11 of this chapter. Likely unknown to him at the time, the dream pointed to the future, however, when God would move Joseph to Egypt and he would rise to power. We know this from the end of the story. Rise to power, he becomes a ruler, and God gave him the dream, but God did not explain to Joseph when it would happen or how it would happen, and the brothers had no idea either. You're having a dream and you're literally walking in the dark going, I don't know what... I mean, you could infer from the dream, if you wanted to interpret it, well, this should happen tomorrow. You know, sometimes like God maybe speaks about something, or God, you think, well, this is going to happen tomorrow. And God's like, no, it's not going to happen for a long time. I have a plan. Joseph's dad sent Joseph to check on his brothers who are away from home taking care of the flock. Remember that part of the text? Our text in verse 13 tells us specifically that Jacob said to Joseph, come, I will send you to them. And then in verse 14, we read the words, so he sent him. But wait a second, in Genesis 45, Joseph says, you didn't send me. God did. God did it. Joseph encounters, remember in the story, a man who finds him wandering in the field and asking him, what are you seeking? This random man out of nowhere in the text that we're told nothing really about other than there's a guy there wandering in the fields and he sees Joseph, and that guy just happens to know where Joseph's brothers are. Joseph's brothers hated him for being the favorite son and getting special treatment from dad. Joseph's brothers were bitter and jealous. They conspired to have Joseph killed. But instead, they altered their plan, didn't they? Their initial plan was altered. Instead, they had him thrown down into the pit and said, let us sell him. And what did that result in? Well, the caravan coming along and being sold to them and sending Joseph to Egypt. Again, I read to you the words of Genesis 5. Was all that just a chance? Was Genesis 37 just a chance? In fact, I was going to title this message, Not a Chance. Not a chance that this is all just a chance. Right? We don't believe in chance. We don't believe in luck as Christian people, right? We shouldn't believe in chance and luck. We believe in providence. We believe in sovereignty. So was all this a chance? Not at all, friends. Now contrast the details of what we've just read again with Genesis 45. Joseph says to his brothers, and now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves, because you sent me here or sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. Notice the purpose. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest, and God sent me again before you, notice the purpose, to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. But if you read Genesis 37, it sure looks like they sent him, doesn't it? But it was God. He has made me, that is, God has made me a father to Pharaoh and Lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Friends, we call this in theological circles, we call this providence. We call it the hand of providence. Jacob intended for Joseph to just check on his brothers. A man intended for Joseph to find his brothers. Joseph's brothers intended to harm Joseph by selling him to traitors. But God had a different intention altogether. God intended to get Joseph to Egypt. They intended evil, but God intended it for good. God was the one who had the master plan to get Joseph to Egypt to accomplish his purposes in Joseph's life, a plan that would have far-reaching impact on his family and many others for generations to come, actually. Regarding this invisible hand of God, R.C. Sproul, in his book called The Invisible Hand, says this: If we play the what-if game with Joseph, we go back to the technicolored coat. If there had been no coat, notice this, perhaps there would not have been so much jealousy among his brothers. It's not a chance that the coat was bought. No jealousy, no selling to the Midianite traders. And if the Midianite traders had been headed in the opposite direction, Joseph would never have gone to Egypt. No selling to Potiphar. Had someone else purchased him, there would have been no encounter with Potiphar's wife, which we'll read about next week. No Potiphar's wife, there would be no prison time. No prison, there would be no meeting, as we'll find in the days ahead, with the baker and the butler in prison. No meeting with the butler, no meeting with Pharaoh to interpret the dream. No meeting with Pharaoh, and Joseph would not have become, or never become, the prime minister over Egypt. None of it would have happened. Not a chance. The game goes on, Sproul says. He says, if Joseph had never become prime minister, then the Jews would never have settled in the land of Goshen. Had that not occurred, there would never have been an enslavement of the Jewish people in Egypt. No slavery, no need for the rescue of a crying baby named Moses. No Moses, no Exodus. No Exodus, no law. And the game continues all the way to Jesus and his redemption on the cross. If we telescope this collection of what ifs, we conclude that if it were not for Joseph's technicolored coat, there would be no Christianity. And every chapter of human history would have a different ending. That is amazing. That is absolutely amazing. This coat, of all things, this coat. Friends, God is writing your biography. What chapter is he writing today? Is it a chapter like Genesis 37? Is it a chapter filled with uncertainty and confusion? Is it a chapter where you're having a hard time seeing God's plan for your life? What I hope you'll take away from this message today is two simple truths. First of all, God has a plan for you even when you cannot see his plan. God's invisible hand is guiding you through all the various chapters of your life, and in concurrence with all the stuff that other people do, somehow in his sovereignty, he sorts through all the mess of people and sin and decisions and choices to still bring about his plan, because he's God. The story of your life, I hope you will know, is greater than the chapters that are being written, because the chapters are a point in time and not the full picture. I think of Cory ten Boom at this point. She was a Dutch watchmaker, and she helped many Jewish people escape from the Nazis during the Holocaust and World War II by hiding them in her home. The famous book, The Hiding Place, tells the story. She was caught. She was sent to a concentration camp. And she has this way of thinking about life as a tapestry. She says, as things unfold in time, in your life, it's like viewing the backside of a tapestry. It appears to be nothing more than a jumble of thread, if you ever looked at a tapestry on the backside, a jumble of thread, tangled, frayed, occasionally knotted, and seemingly random. You look at that back and you're just like, it's just a big mess on the backside. Nothing really makes sense if you look at it. It's no wonder people lose heart, give up, and abandon their commitments because they think, well, if that's what life is like, you look at the backside and you're like, yeah, boy, life is an absolute mess. But things are not always what they seem. It's only when you turn a tapestry over that you see the art, the rich colors, the texture, the patterns that can make a tapestry a thing of astonishing beauty. Likewise, occasionally God gives us a glimpse at what he is weaving into the fabric of our lives. The momentary peek at glory gives us the courage to soldier on, knowing that nothing happens by accident. No thread of experience, good or bad, is wasted. When it appears to be that way, we just have to remind ourselves that we are simply looking at the backside of the tapestry. And the one weaving it together knows precisely what he's doing. And that leads to the second point of application. The first one was knowing that God has a plan even when you can't see it. The second one is that God can be trusted even when you can't see it. You see, that takes faith. To trust that God has a plan, even when you can't see it. Cory ten Boom had also said, and it's a famous quote of hers, never be afraid to trust a known unknown future to a known God. Friends, I don't know what God is weaving in your life, what the storyline is saying at this point, but I do know by faith that we can trust his word. And we trust his word because we can trust him. That he's working out a plan. And though we don't see it now, you trust in the one who's been so faithful and will be so faithful to you throughout all the days of your life. Because every one of them are written in a book before one of them ever came to pass. And you are precious in his sight. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this morning. Lord, I'm humbled by who you are, Lord, just retelling this story, Lord, in the scriptures of that you are so, so much greater than we are, Lord. Like, Lord, our minds can barely grab a picture of you, Lord, because of how amazing you are. Lord, would you help us to trust you? For my friends that are gathered here that right now are in a chapter, a season of their life where it's tough slugging, would you help them, Lord, to know that you are at work? Yes. Your hand is an invisible hand at times, but your hand is still there. The story is not over. You're still writing it. So, Lord, build faith in them today. Give them encouragement. Give them courage, Lord, to trust you. And I pray that you would help their hearts to be at peace and rest with you. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.